60s. Hello, good evening. Former Home Affairs Secretary Patrick Ho has been arrested in the United States for allegedly leading a $10 million bribery scandal involving a Chinese company and African authorities. If convicted, he faces up to 20 years behind bars. Winner Wong tells us more. Patrick Ho was arrested in New York along with the former foreign minister of Senegal, Chick Gadio. In a statement released on Monday, acting Manhattan attorney June Kim said, the pair were arrested because they allegedly conspired to bribe African government officials on behalf of a Chinese energy conglomerate. Kim called it an international corruption scheme that spanned the globe. The statement also accused them of seeking to pay bribes to the president of Chad, Idris Deby, and the foreign minister of Uganda, Sam Kutesa. The money was wired through New York's banking system. What's more, the statement said Ho's scheme with a Ugandan official was apparently hatched inside the halls of the United Nations in New York when Kutesa was president of the UN General Assembly. At the center of the alleged bribery were a Chinese rising star company and African governments. The statement released by the U.S. Department of Justice stopped short of mentioning the name of the Chinese energy conglomerate, but details point to the Shanghai-based CEFC China Energy. The company has been a key player in President Xi Jinping's Belt and Road Initiative, with investments in the Middle East, Africa, and Russia. It also owns thousands of petrol stations in Europe and has a stake in Czech Airlines. In a statement released tonight, the CEFC Hong Kong Fund Committee cut ties with Ho, saying it has always operated in accordance with the laws of various countries. The organization, which introduces itself as a non-governmental global think tank, fully funded by CEFC China FA, said it did not authorize anyone to carry out the so-called business activities reported by the media. Winner Wong, TVB News.
The government today issued a statement on the progress of the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge project. Work on the main bridge section is said to be going well, but there's an estimated cost overrun of around 10 billion yuan. Caleb Long reports.
According to the government's press release, the construction of the main bridge of the Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge project is progressing well. At the moment, the bridge section and the subsea tunnel section of the main bridge have been connected. However, according to a report to the State Council, there may be a cost overrun of around 10 billion yuan for the main bridge. That's because of a rise in construction costs resulting from increases in labor and material costs, as well as the refinement of the design and construction schemes. Under the current arrangement, the main bridge's construction cost is financed by the mainland Hong Kong and Macau. The government will seek the Legislative Council's approval for the required additional funding once the amount to be financed by Hong Kong is confirmed. Financial Secretary Paul Chan stressed that the government will give a clear explanation to LegCo. As the project's targeted finish date is around the end of this year, Chan thinks it's too early to say whether the additional funding issue would affect the completion date. Chen Hanpen, chairman of LegCo's transport panel, says Hong Kong has to share 43% of the cost under the current arrangement. Therefore, the territory is expected to shell out an extra 4.3 billion yuan. He has demanded that the government give a detailed explanation on the cost overrun. Meanwhile, Guangdong province authorities will be holding a public consultation session in Zhuhai on the bridge's toll fees. Hong Kong residents can also sign up for the event. Peter Bloom, TVB News.
Executive Carrie Lam stressed her government's determination to promote the city's creative industries at an entrepreneurship forum this evening, though businessman Jack Ma offered a somewhat different tip on how to get a better head.
Don't wait for the environment to be ready. Don't wait for all the policy ready. When everything's ready, there's no opportunity for you. You have to move faster before the government take action. If the government say everything's ready, you should move to the other area, because that there's no chance for you. Right?
But cultural change is not something the government or this government could do. So it relies on every one of you in the audience to give that strong supporter. It would be very disappointing to see that when young people are now very innovative, very willing to take some risks, but their parents said no.
The SAR government has asked Beijing to nominate an official to speak at an upcoming seminar on the Communist Party's 19th National Congress report. Chief Executive Carrie Lam called this part of the government's usual practice to enhance senior public servants' understanding about developments in the nation. More from Caleb Long.
President Xi Jinping outlined his vision for the country in a report delivered at the 19th CPC National Congress last month. Chief Executive Carrie Lam confirmed this morning that a seminar will be held in Hong Kong later this week for principal officials and senior civil servants to learn more about the subject. The government asked the central authorities to nominate an official to speak at the seminar. Leung Rong, director of the Communist Party's Literature Research Center, will come to the city to brief public servants on the spirit of President Xi's Party Congress report. The arrangement, the chief executive insists, is not out of the norm.
The Hong Kong SAR government has been organizing a series of national affairs seminars. So whenever there are important things in the mainland, we will request the central government to nominate the most relevant official to come to Hong Kong to host a seminar to talk about that particular subject.
Lam noted that Xi mentioned in his report about how Beijing would include the Hong Kong and Macau SARs in the country's development plan. She thinks it is essential for local public servants to understand what the plan is, as well as how to be part of the plan. Meanwhile, a number of local community organizations also see a need to thoroughly study Xi's report. The Federation of Hong Kong Guangdong Community Organizations held a seminar on the subject this morning. He Jing, a deputy director of central government's liaison office, spoke at the seminar, which was attended by around 700 people. Caleb Leung, TVB News.
Turning overseas now, the United States has officially labeled North Korea as a sponsor of terror. As Sonia Otero reports, the move is aimed at containing nuclear threats by the country's leader and persuading other countries to stop doing business with Pyongyang.
Today, the United States is designating North Korea as a state sponsor of terrorism. Should have happened a long time ago.
North Korea spent 20 years on the terror list until President George W. Bush removed it in 2008 in a bid to salvage negotiations aimed at halting Pyongyang's nuclear ambitions. Those talks collapsed soon after and haven't been revived since. That goodwill gesture festered more evil, insists President Donald Trump.
In addition to threatening the world by nuclear devastation, North Korea has repeatedly supported acts of international terrorism, including assassinations on foreign soil.
North Korea now joins three nations on the terrorism blacklist, including Iran, Sudan, and Syria. Trump hopes additional sanctions will pressure Pyongyang to stand down. Japan's prime minister welcomed the move. Shinzo Abe agreed with Trump on pressuring Pyongyang with harsher sanctions. China reacted by saying it hopes all parties can resolve the issue peacefully. A message expressed right as a special envoy from China continued its visit to North Korea yesterday. The group was seen at the China-North Korea Friendship Tower, which was built to mark Chinese contributions during the Korean War. With the help of other countries, the U.S. Secretary of State made it clear their main goal is to further isolate Pyongyang.
It may, though, disrupt and dissuade some third parties from undertaking certain activities with North Korea, and we continue to turn the pressure up on North Korea by getting other countries to join and take actions on their own.
And this message was aimed directly at their leaders.
The best way we can help the North Korean people in the future is to have Kim Jong-un reverse his nuclear weapons program, allow us and the rest of the world to then engage with them in economic activity that will ultimately provide a better life for his people.
Sonia Artero, TVB News.
In London, key cabinet members have reportedly agreed to the UK offering more money to the European Union as part of the proposed separation deal. The EU's top Brexit negotiator is taking an uncompromising approach to the Brexit talks, saying Britain must offer solutions on outstanding issues. James Aiken reports.
The latest development followed a two-hour meeting of the Cabinet and Exit Trade Subcommittee late last night. Reports say Britain is preparing to double its exit offer to the equivalent of almost $50 billion. The move is an attempt to accelerate exit negotiations and encourage the EU to start vital trade talks in mid-December. Ahead of the meeting, Prime Minister Theresa May, who will meet European Council President Donald Tusk on Friday, said negotiations are constructive.
Our progress has been made in a number of areas on issues like citizens' rights. For example, I want to see the UK and the EU moving forward together, ensuring that we have that deep and special relationship in the future.
The EU wants Britain to provide clear proposals soon to find a way to leave the bloc in 2019, but continue to have a transparent open border between Northern Ireland and EU member Ireland. Top negotiators say the next few weeks will be crucial and have suggested compromises will be unlikely.
UK voices suggest that Brexit does not mean Brexit. Brexit means Brexit. The UK has chosen to leave the EU. Respect this choice. Does it want to stay close to the European model? Or does it want to gradually move away from it? And the UK's reply to these questions will be very important and even decisive, because it will shape the discussion on our future relationship.
Meanwhile, EU members have picked cities from France and the Netherlands to host key agencies that will have to move once Britain leaves the bloc. Amsterdam was chosen as the new home of the European Medicines Agency, and Paris was picked to host the European Banking Authority. Both currently are located in London. The relocations are expected to cost Britain more than 1,000 jobs directly and more in secondary employment. James Aiken, TVB News.
Zimbabwe's parliament is now entering the next stage of the impeachment process against President Robert Mugabe. Members are now forming a committee to investigate the allegations against Mugabe, including that he allowed his wife to usurp constitutional power and that he is of advanced age. Mugabe also is accused of allowing unpopular First Lady Grace Mugabe to threaten to kill the recently fired vice president and other officials. The impeachment motion was introduced by the ruling party and seconded by the opposition.
Comrade Energy Mugabe has been formally notified of the decisions this morning. As for that, the party has instructed the chief whip to proceed with impeachment processes against Comrade Energy Mugabe, as it has not received the anticipated confirmation of his resignation from the Speaker of Parliament.
And finally tonight, hundreds of items along the ancient Silk Road will be on display next week, and some of them are more than 2,000 years old. These natural treasures are in town for the first time. It may look new, but this silk pillow is well over 2,000 years old. Even after all these years, the silk stitchings of the rooster's eyes are still very much visible. But why shape it like a rooster?
The chicken is kind of symbol of good fortune in the Chinese ancient belief. So the finding of such a kind of pillow in chicken style signifies that there were cultural interaction between the central China and also the Xinjiang region.
This mythical beast made of pure gold also has more than 2,000 years history. With craftsmanship like this, the ornament is regarded as the most representative example among rare Xiongnu art pieces. But let's not leave out the camels of the Silk Road. This one was glazed back in the Tang Dynasty some 1,500 years ago. This exhibition features a section of the ancient trade route which stretched from China to Central Asia, listed as UNESCO World Heritage in 2014. That is why visitors will also see artifacts found outside of China.
It is the first time for the Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan artifacts coming to Hong Kong. Appreciate the artifacts and to know more about the interaction and also the integration between the culture of China and also the Central Asian countries.
From early December, there will also be free guided tours for the public. While Cantonese ones are conducted on a daily basis, English ones will only be available on Saturdays, Sundays, and public holidays. The exhibition kicks off next Wednesday at the Hong Kong Museum of History and will run until March.
After given investment instructions, your trustee will send a notice to let you choose whether to invest your MPF benefits according to the DIS.
不买地盘，建议你两位去德克福门测试，注意一下做师傅啊。要咗你哋做。
Weather before we go, it will be mainly cloudy with sunny intervals and a low temperature of 18 degrees. And that's the news. Thanks for watching. Good night.